Retro.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, this is Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome back to Podcast Stardust, the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. We'll be getting to the penultimate episode of Season 2 of Rebels on this show, but before we do, Jay, where can everybody find us on social media?
Well, there's no mystery about where to find us. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right, so we, of course, have been covering Rebels on a weekly basis, but then we ran into the debut of the Bad Batch, so we've kind of been breaking this up onto an every other week to finish out the season. This is a episode that is good, it's interesting, and will set us up nicely for the final episode of the season. But with that preliminary out of the way, the dish is aligned, the signal's boosted to maximum output, the shield is down, and we are now broadcasting the galaxy. Let's get into this week's episode of Rebels. And as I was saying earlier, this is episode 20 of season 2, The Mystery of Chopper Base. Jay, if you could give us the summary, please.
Sure thing. The Rebels have established a new base on what appears to be a largely deserted world. However, when a lieutenant does not return from setting up a sensor, Sabine and Rex investigate. They are attacked by large spider-like monsters called the Krikna, and they manage to capture Rex and drag him off to their lair. Hera, Kanan, Ezra, Zeb, and Sabine infiltrate the Krikna's caves to rescue Rex. After fighting off the creatures, they successfully retrieve Rex and make their way back to the Ghost. However, they can't lift off as the Krikna have webbed the ship to the ground. As the monsters attack the ship, Sabine realizes the rebellion sensors keep them away. Ezra devises a plan, and they manage to retrieve a sensor and use it to protect themselves while they free the ship. Once back at the base, Sabine encourages Kanan to talk to Hera. The Jedi are preparing to depart to confront the Inquisitors, and it has resulted in some mixed feelings for Hera. She and Kanan smooth things over, and then Ahsoka finds Ezra on the base's perimeter and tells him it is time to go.
So, it's a good episode. It is not quite as important to the overall plotline of Rebels as some of the episodes we've been discussing leading up to this one, I think. Kind of like the Forgotten Droid when introduced AP-5. Anyway, I mean, that one at least brought us AP-5. This one is our send-off into the finale, but you didn't necessarily have to have this story to get anywhere when it comes down to it. But that being said, what did you think about it overall?
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. And I hate to use the word filler. You know, we hear that word a lot when it comes to episodes like this, where it doesn't, like as you said, have to even exist per se, but it does bring us these interesting spider-like Krikna creatures and sets us up for the fact that they're leaving. You know, Kanan, Ezra, and Ahsoka are all leaving to find the Inquisitors, and also kind of gives us that feeling of how desperate the Rebellion is to set up a base somewhere that they can't be found. And, you know, that this happens to be the world that they ended up choosing.
Right. And I agree with you on the term filler. The objection I have to that is that not every series that's ever been out there has had a story arc that ran the course of an entire season of the show, let alone the entire series, so to speak. And so there was no such thing as a filler episode. A filler episode might be a best of clip show type mm-hmm. of a thing. This show is worthy in its own regards. It has a story to it. And so, and again, I'm with you. I don't particularly like that filler label that gets tossed around, I think, when something falls outside of perhaps the main story arc for a season. You can still enjoy the story for what it's worth. And it's a good story. So mm-hmm. there we are. But again, we get these Krikna, these giant space spiders, and we remember them because recently we've seen them in the second episode of season two of The Mandalorian, which was the passenger episode when they crashed in those ice caves. There was a species of these Krikna there, and then the Mandalorian and Grogu and this little frog lady had to fight for their lives and get back to the ship, the Razor Crest, because they were being pursued by all manner of Krikna at the time. And they're, again, based off a Ralph McQuarrie concept, these spiders were supposed to show up on Dagobah at some point in the planning for that movie, in The Empire Strikes Back, I should say. But I forgot how different they were in Rebels. And primarily, they were impervious to blasters unless you managed to shoot them in the eye.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And I think I was trying to remember, too, because I know in the Rebels recon that they talked about the fact that they only had six legs as opposed to the eight that mm-hmm. you see in the McQuarrie concept, because they just said that, you know, six legs are just easier to work with as an animated asset. So I couldn't remember, though, are the spiders that we see in The Mandalorian, how many legs did they have? Do you know? Do you remember?
I didn't count. I just remember after watching that episode and doing some research on the spiders, mm-hmm. them definitely being tied to these spiders. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know that they are exactly the same species. Yeah, they may be something like an Asian elephant to an African elephant, similar, but just enough of a difference there, or, you know, different species of dogs or cats or whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. But similar, but not entirely the same, because those spiders in the ice cave in the Mandalorian, you could destroy with a blaster shot. You'd have to hit them in the eye in order to do that. And in fact, when the Republic X-Wing pilots showed up, they just started blasting the spiders and they didn't necessarily have to hit any of them in the eye. They just picked them all off that mm-hmm. way. So exactly. These were a different breed. And what did you think of them overall in general, beyond their comparison to what we've seen before?
Well, I just remember when I saw this for the first time, it was just creepy. I mean, spiders in general are just creepy. Mm-hmm. And when they're on this type of a scale, they're even worse. But what I thought was kind of interesting too is the fact that Ezra really, really tried to connect with these things and he couldn't.
Right.
As much as he put that effort into it. And it just goes to show that there's just not, just because it's a living thing doesn't necessarily mean that you are going to be able to crack that shell, so to speak, and be able to connect.
Right. And that was something that they were talking about in the Rebels recon that came with this episode. And I guess the way it was Dave Filoni and Pablo Hidalgo were explaining it was that Adelon, this planet they're on, is far enough removed that has not really been within the Empire's notice. And there's nobody there. It doesn't have resources. It's not a planet anybody wants. And so it's kind of been left alone. And the creatures there are from a very old age. And they just kind of are outside the common experience. And so it's not something that would be easy for any Jedi to make a connection mm-hmm. with. And that's something that Ezra is having a hard time coming to grips with, that he's learning that lesson, that just because you have the skill doesn't mean it's always going to translate.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. But Adelon is going to play a very big role later on, but
oh yeah. Yeah.
We won't talk about that yet.
Yeah. It'll come up time again next season. So again, they've set up Chopper Base, which I think is appropriate because it was AP-5 and Chopper that led the rebellion there when after they helped the rebellion escape that ambush in the Forgotten Droid episode. But the episode starts as the crew of the Ghost are kind of making a supply delivery to Adelon. And while that is going on, Ezra and Kanan are sparring in the cargo hold of the ship, and they've got their lightsabers tuned to a training setting, but they never actually hit each other, so I'm not sure what the point was. But it is kind of an intense setting there, and we come to understand that they're preparing themselves to confront the Inquisitors, that they and Ahsoka have realized that they've kind of got to stop running at some point and remove this threat to the rebellion. And so they're going at it fairly intense, pulling out all the stops. We get that moment where Ezra kind of flips off the wall, lands behind Kanan, and puts his saber up next to Kanan's neck and says, I win, I got you, I win. And then Kanan says, well, I got you too. And you look down and Kanan's got the reverse grip on his saber and it's pointing right at Ezra's belly. Mm-hmm. And then Kanan makes this point that there's no ties. It's either you win and you live or you lose and you die. And then later when Sabine and Hera are making comments on their sparring, Kanan takes a swing at Ezra from behind and points out to Ezra that you never turn your back on an enemy. And he's like, well, since when have you been my enemy? It's just right. Do you feel like Kanan maybe backslid a little bit after the episode where they went back to the Jedi Temple on Lothal and he kind of came to that realization that all he can do is train Ezra the best he can, and then it's ultimately up to Ezra to not fall to the dark side and not get slaughtered in combat and everything like that? I feel like Kanan maybe forgot that lesson a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know if it's so much that he is backsliding so much as he's getting to the point where, I don't know if the word is desperation, but I try to put myself almost in the position of Kanan being Ezra's parent, in that, you know, you want to try to prepare your child for anything that they're going to come up against in adulthood, and you're okay and you've made that resolution within you that you know it's going to happen, they're going to leave the nest, they're going to do this, but yet when it comes time to actually do it, you don't want to let go. So I think that that's maybe kind of where Kanan is right now with Ezra, is that yes, they realize that they've got to go do this, but yet he doesn't want to face it in some ways. So I don't know if that's necessarily backsliding or if it's maybe being in denial a little bit. I'm not sure.
To me, he seemed like, we're determined, we're going to go do this. And the bigger problem is leaving Hera and the rebellion behind and the issue that causes. And we'll get to that in just a second. But the whole attacking Ezra from behind thing is like, you know, you never turn your back on an enemy. It's like, wait, you guys are interrupted and you're both engaged in a conversation here.
Yeah.
So what is this? The thing is this is kind of something that happens frequently in Rebels, especially with Ezra and the dark side later. It's like every time you think he's learned and he's put that lesson behind him, they kind of tease that he's susceptible to that again. And that comes up a lot next season, but we won't go into specifics here.
Right,
and
right.
Again, Kanan has these self-doubts about teaching, and then it'll come up when he tries to help Sabine learn something later as well. So I don't know, just something that it's just a momentary thing, and it wasn't that big an aspect of this episode, but I just couldn't it just was a little bit like, I thought we just covered this type of an issue, but I get it. Different people are writing these episodes and they shoot them and they go forward and there it is. So moving on. So they get to the chopper base and they deliver their surprise, and it's no secret that Ezra and Kanan are getting ready to leave. And we get a couple moments throughout this episode where Hera's a little cold to Kanan about things. And, you know, for instance, when they're in the Krikna's caves and they're going to split up to try and find Rex, and the suggestion is made that there's one Jedi on each team, and Hera says no, Ezra goes with Kanan, Sabine and Zeb are with Hera. And as the Jedi run off, she's like, we have to learn how to get used to them not being around. And there's just kind of this anger, resentment just boiling under the surface a little bit. And it takes them getting back to Chopper Base at the end of the episode, where Sabine has to tell Kanan, it's like, you should go talk to Hera. And he's like, well, why? And she face palms. She's like,
yes,
she may support what you're doing, but you're walking out on us. So
exactly.
What did you think of this entire aspect of the show?
Well, for Hera, I think that some of that comes down to just a defense mechanism on her part, where it's almost easier to be withdrawn and angry than it is to face that separation. It's it's almost in a protective mode for her. But, you know, I know that in Kanan is completely tunnel visioned in this whole thing, as Sabine points out to him, you know, that he can't even see, almost like, you know, like the hand in front of his face kind of thing. And yeah, it's rough, I think, for both of them, because I don't think either one of them really wants to admit necessarily that they have such deep feelings for each other. And it's, you know, when they embrace there at the end, which I love that shot, by the way, that they almost reluctantly kind of warm into each other's arms and kind of melt into each other's arms. And because they don't want to face the fact that they have to separate. And both of them have been loners for so long, and they've had that kind of protective shell for so long. So it's, you know, there's things all over the place, but they're both just very strong personalities. And I think that that's what's working against them, if that's the way we want to put it.
Right. And the other thing is, it's like, again, when these episodes came out, there was this tension between Hera and Kanan at all times. And it was kind of like, well, are they in a relationship? Do they have these feelings for each other? We get statements from Freddie Prinze Jr. saying, you know, they've already been there, but they don't have time for it now. And then on the opposite side, you got Vanessa Marshall saying, sure, she calls everybody love, and it's not a, you know, a romantic love that she's using when talking to Kanan and stuff like that. And so they were very coy about that, the creators and producers and actors in this show. And now, looking back with the benefit of hindsight and what the conclusion of the series is, there's just that extra tenderness added to the episode, especially when she's telling him that, you know, I support what you're trying to do, but I wanted to be able to face this with you. You know, something that we would face together, that we'd confront together. And it is more than just a team. It is a relationship type of a sentiment that's going on there.
Mm-hmm, definitely. And that pulls at your heartstrings too, when she said that, because you could just feel that, just almost, again, almost the desperation there. I wanted to face this with you. I thought we would do this together. And there's a lot of frustration there and a lot of hurt.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things I want to talk a bit about is just the action here. We get a lot of great scenes in the Krikna's tunnels, caverns, caves, whatever you want to call them. And then as they're trying to liberate the ghost from the webbing that the Krikna put up. You never actually saw the Krikna put the webs there. They just showed up, which is fine. The effect of the sabers burning it away when they slash through was really, really cool for animation. It's something that you could totally see live action doing them. But when I saw that, I was like, that's really pretty neat the way they did that for an animated series. But one of the things that stood out to me is how much the Krikna were like the aliens from the Alien franchise in this episode, and that the way they scampered around their tunnels coming after the people, then they came in, they infiltrated the ghost through the airlock in that one spot, and how they just kind of swarmed up and over things. I don't know that they took any influence from Alien, but I definitely felt that vibe.
Oh yeah. I mean, it upped the creepy factor for sure.
Mm-hmm. And then when Sabine came up with the realization that they don't like those sensors, you know, they're putting these sensors out in the field so that they'd have some warning if any other ship touched down on the planet or in the vicinity, they'd know it was coming. But when they were looking for Lieutenant Dicer and they couldn't find her, some of these Krikna came up on Sabine and she happened to be next to that sensor, and they wouldn't get anywhere near her. And then later from the cabin of the ghost, she saw one of them react negatively to the sensor. So Ezra comes to this plan that they're gonna, Kanan and Ezra are gonna fling her through the force towards the sensor, except for they overshoot.
They do. And then they freak out and they're like, whoa, why didn't you just pull her back? And that's when she says, now would be a really great time to have a jetpack.
Yeah. And I was like, I was with you. It was like, why didn't you control that a little bit better?
Exactly.
But
like, they were just going to stand by and watch her get impaled by the sensor or something.
Well, you know, it's an interesting, I don't want to use the filler word here. This is an episode that was a lot lighter on the dialogue, the important dialogue, like we got to track this down and this means this and we're being followed here and here's a development here. It really was about a friend gets kidnapped by these creatures. We have to go rescue them. Now we have to get away on our ship. And the real pivotal moments, the series arc changing moments, came at the beginning and the end of the episode. Yeah. And so I think maybe they had to throw in Sabine getting overthrown, just add an extra moment of tension to the episode. But there it is. So she gets back with the sensor. They free the ship and then they escape and then they get back to the base. Question. Did they just give up on Lieutenant Dicer? Because they found Rex alive, but no one thought to look for her again.
Right. I know. I was thinking the same thing. And I actually kind of rewound it a couple of times to see if I had missed her making it back to the base. Okay. But I don't think that that was ever mentioned. I think you're, yeah, it's still a mystery. Maybe that's the mystery of Chopper Bays. Who knows?
Right. But they found her helmet, and they had one of those little snail-looking creatures underneath it. They're called Dachmas, but Zeb was referring to them as Bogans.
Bogans, yeah.
Yeah. I don't even want that for the little Bogans. But, but again, no one even bothered to ask later what happened to her. So I think it's probably just this time-saving device for a 22-minute episode or something. But okay, it's been nice to know. Poor Lieutenant Dicer.
Hopefully she didn't get diced up by those Krikna legs. Yeah, sorry.
But the episode ends with, well, actually, before we get to the end, one of the scenes I want to touch on there is they've set up the base, they delivered the slides, the supplies, and before they even start having these problems with the Krikna, Zeb has set up himself a little bunker, and he's got a chair that he's lounging in, he's enjoying a drink, and he's got music blaring out of a radio, and he's watching the sunset, and Ezra kind of comes up on him, and they start talking, and Zeb invites him to pull up a crate and watch the sunset. I really like that scene. There's been kind of a sibling rivalry, especially with Zeb, Ezra, and Chopper over the first two seasons here. And in a way, Zeb is kind of like always been looking out for Ezra, and not looking down, but kind of like looking at him as a younger brother. But I felt like he was treating Ezra much more as an equal here, and with a lot more respect than he typically gave Ezra.
Definitely. And I'm so glad that you brought that up too, because this is, for me anyways, this was like the 1980s Maverick and Goose moment between the two of them, you know, kind of this bonding with the 80s music kind of feel blasting. But you're right. I mean, they've definitely got this camaraderie. And as you said, as much as that quote unquote sibling rivalry, there is quite a lot of respect and reverie for each other.
Yeah. Because Ezra expressed a little doubt that they'd even make it back from this. And Zeb's like, oh, you absolutely will. And then we'll trade war stories. Because the thought is that Ezra, Kanan, and Ahsoka are going off on this quest to defeat the Inquisitors. And they could be gone for a really long time. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, the rest of the rebellion is going to be fighting against the Empire. And so these two different battles might end simultaneously or about the same time. And then they'll be able to meet up. They don't know that they're ever going to see each other again at this point. And so, I don't know. I said at the beginning of this episode that it's not necessarily crucial to the overall story arc here, but there are a lot of good character moments in this episode.
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
And then the episode ends with Ezra taking one last attempt while he's kind of at the sensor fence that the Krikna are beyond. And he tries to reach out to one, doesn't work. And then he just is like, fine, I guess we won't be friends. And he lays down and he's kind of looking to the skies. And he sees one of those convoys flying around. And then Ahsoka looms into the picture and is looking down on him. And she basically tells him it's time to get up and go, because they're getting to go on their mission. But he's expressing his frustration with making a connection to the Krikna. And she says, my experience, just when you think you understand the Force, you find out how little you actually know. And if that doesn't say it all about Star Wars and the Force, I don't know what does.
Yes. Yes. I love that quote. Absolutely. And I love the way that the convoy is so inherently tied to Ahsoka as well. I mean, it's just her calling card.
Yeah. It just, he noticed it flying around and there she was. So.
Yep. Yep.
And then the last funny gag I wanted to bring up was they're heading into the caves to find Rex, and Zeb is trying to ignite a flashlight. He's having troubles with it. And then Ezra just kind of pulls out his lightsaber and ignites it and gives Zeb that look, that grin. That gets repeated in The Rise of Skywalker.
Thank you.
With
Poe
and Rey.
Oh my gosh. And you know what I think is so great too? And I'm so glad that you brought that up, because I thought the exact same thing. Is that now that we're revisiting these episodes, you see these relationships with things that, you know, we can tie together from other places like movies and whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's magical. I love it.
Well, and it was such a clever, funny little thing to put in there. I mean, it's a second and a half, that little bit there, but I forgot about it completely until I rewatched it today.
Mm-hmm.
And we were just talking about Ezra and Zeb's relationship. And that was just a funny little a part to kind of highlight that, you know, Zeb's trying to get the flashlight to work and Ezra just gives him the smirk and ignites his lightsaber. The look on Zeb's face was like, oh, that guy. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I think that brings us then to the end of the episode. Did you have any final thoughts on this one?
Well, I just think it's cool that they named it Chopper Base, you know, after a good old chopper. But other than that, I think we pretty much hit on all of the highlights here and said what we needed to say. So yeah, good episode.
Yeah. So if you're watching Rebels on Disney Plus, I think they divide up the finale into two episodes. But if you're looking at the series guide on StarWars.com, they treat the finale as just one single episode, which is what we're going to do. However, we won't be doing it for 2 weeks. Next week, we've got something else for our Wednesday discussion, and then we'll be getting to the season finale the week after that. But just wanted to give everyone a heads up if they're following along and watching these episodes in advance for our discussions. But we can't wait to get to that because that is a huge, huge episode with plenty of repercussions and quite possibly one of the best episodes of the entire series. So most impactful. But we will be with you in 2 weeks to discuss that one. But with that having been said, I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and this week's discussion of Rebels. We'd also like to remind you, as always, we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network and that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust on RetroZap.com. Naturally, you can find Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, Audible, or your podcatcher of choice, and that includes the RetroZap podcast feed. And if you would be so kind, we'd greatly appreciate a rating and review over on Apple Podcasts. And if you aren't using that, your podcatcher of choice is always a great one and appreciated. And please don't forget to look us up on social media and say hello. Jay, can you remind everybody what our social media contacts are and where else they can find us around the internet, please?
Yes, and hello to all of our new followers and listeners. And for anyone else that would like to connect with us, you can do so on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can find Dennis over on Twitter at DJKVER2, and I'm at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out my cosplay Instagram over on JSnips Cosplay and see what I'm up to with Ahsoka and Rey and whatever else I tend to get into. Planning some things for Celebration, so we'll see. We'll see if that happens. And we also have a Pinterest board for Podcast Stardust, as well as our YouTube channel, where you can find all of our episodes and our unboxing videos of some really great products. And you can also catch us for some chatter over on Discord. We are just one of many rooms on the RetroZap Discord server. Just go to our community tab on our show page. It'll take you right to where you need to go. And last but not least, you can always support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can pick up one of a number of different show logo designs for t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, phone cases, stickers, magnets, you name it. And it's probably over there. So head on over there. They're always having some good sales. And we'd love it if you'd take pictures and tag us on our social media.
Alrighty then, that'll do it for episode 264 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.